New time Thursday nights at 9 o'clock.
It's back to school time. Come to the Gospel Tent next to the Eden Mall September the 19th through the 30th. We're studying the Scripture, teaching the truth, and giving you the Gospel. No collections will be taken. Your questions are welcome.
You saw a plane?
Yes, I just saw a plane go into the building.
I think we have a terrorist attack of proportions that we cannot begin to imagine at this juncture.
Today, our fellow citizens, our way of life, our very freedom came under attack in a series of deliberate and deadly terrorist acts.
Everyone remembers where they were 10 years ago on September the 11th. It was a day that changed our lives forever. September 2011 will bring about another life-changing event. Your friends in the Church of Christ are inviting you to come to the Gospel Tent September the 19th through the 30th at 7 p.m. each night and hear the glorious gospel of Christ that can save your soul. Will you remember where you were on September 2011?
The views expressed on this program do not necessarily reflect the views of the station, its employees, or ownership.
Hello and welcome to What Does the Bible Say? Thank you for tuning in. We're going to be talking about some things that are of utmost importance, things that are spiritual matters. Before we talk about those things, we want to get back and discuss what's going on at the tent and tell you about this program. It's brought to you by the Churches of Christ. Give me just a second. I'm having a problem. Technical difficulties here. This is a program brought to you by the Churches of Christ. Those churches are in Martinsville, Dan, and Eden. And the tent meeting is there in Eden. And James, we're having some trouble here. Get me back to where I need to be. Want to encourage you to come out to the tent meeting. We're having good gospel preaching. Brother Shannon, we're going to hear a clip from him here in just a moment. Everything is provided for by the Churches of Christ. If you come out to visit the tent, we won't ask for any money. We're not going to pass the plate. We're not going to ask for anything of you. You'll be our honored guest. So we want to encourage you to come out, and you can ask any question. At the end of every night, we have a question and answer session. Give you an opportunity to ask any question that you want to ask. You can ask your preacher to come out with you. We would love to have your preacher, your pastor, your rabbi, whatever your religious leader is. We'd love to have them come out and be with us and let them give a defense for the faith that they preach, and let's really examine it and see if it's what the Bible actually is teaching. Did we lose what we needed there? I don't know, we're skipping some slides. Here's the dates for the tent meeting. It's 7 p.m. nightly in Eden there next to the Eden Mall. I want to encourage you to come out to that. Let's see, where are we going here? Here's John, and if you haven't come out to hear John Shannon preach, again, we want to really encourage you to do that. Also, we want to invite you to tune in to our other programs. Of course, we're on tonight. There's the times for our programs. We'll be going to 12 o'clock tonight, and then tomorrow night, also from 10:30 to 12. Wednesday night, we'll be on from 9 to 10. Then Thursday night, we'll be on for 3.5 hours from 8 to 12. With news from 10 to 10:30. And then Friday night we'll close out 8:30 to 10. Of course, all those times are Eastern time. Now, if you haven't been out to the tent, we're going to show you a clip here in just a moment. If we're ready to roll that clip, we'll go ahead and roll it now. This is what you're missing at the tent meeting. We want to encourage you to come out and take a look at this.
Pay tithe. Where did you read that? Don't go to Hebrew. Because Paul was illustrating to the Hebrews that the greater always pay tithe. The less always pay tithe to the greater. Now, where in the New Testament that it tells us to tithe in the New Testament, church? 10%. Where you find that? You folks out there, where you find that? And you people who are listening to me, listen to me. Don't you let these dusty-eyed preachers, whether they're men or women, put some Old Testament stuff on you. They're fooling you. And if you're here tonight, you ought to be ashamed of yourself. You ought to be ashamed. The Catholics tricked me, but you're not going to trick me anymore. No, Lottie. I'm going to read the Bible for myself. Amen, somebody. Apostle doctrine and fellowship. Get your doctrine right, we'll fellowship you. If you don't get your doctrine right, we will not fellowship you. Or Brother Shannon, I'm not mean. I'm telling you the truth. And you ought to hug my neck for telling you the truth. Somebody said, it don't make no difference about the name. One, it don't make no difference about it. Turn Acts 4:11 and 12. Get it now. 10:11 and 12. Somebody said, it don't make no difference about the name. You can't wear what name you want to wear in religion. Be it known unto you and all, and to all the people of Israel, that by the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, whom you crucified, whom God raised from the dead, even by him do this man stand here, ho, come up. This is the stone which set it in order you build it, which is become the head of the corner. Neither is there salvation in any other name. Where in the Bible was somebody called a Pentecostal? Where? Where was it called a Jehovah's Witness? Where were they called an apostolic? Where were they called a Baptist? I mean, where? Not in there. Now, what are you? What are you? What's the name of your church? You say, I got to be easy. Now, you folks in the church, all y'all talking about water. Y'all love water. Y'all love baptism. Well, you Baptists love baptism so well, you name your church after it. Hey, man. Brother Sandy, you better take it easy. You know you're 700 miles from home. And some of these folks...
There we are, folks. That's what we're talking about. We want you to come out to the tent and enjoy simple preaching. We're simply asking the question, are the things that we believe, are they in the Bible or are they not? And we welcome questions. Last night on the television program, we had a couple callers call in and ask us about our authority, and we love that type of a question. Because if we don't have authority from the Scripture for what we're doing, then we need to change. And we're asking folks that we show that they don't have authority for what they believe, we're asking them to change as well. We're asking people to get back to the Bible. And that's really what this program's all about, and that's what the tent's all about. So we want to encourage you, please, come out. You're more than welcome. You will be our honored guest, and certainly we would welcome any questions that you might have. Now, tonight, we are going to consider a topic that it'll concern nearly every one of you that are watching tonight. We're going to talk about a common false doctrine that's presented by the denominational world, and it's based upon a passage. They try to find support from a couple of passages of Scripture in the New Testament for the sinner's prayer. It's taught in a lot of places. I spent 22 years of my life in the Baptist church, and I said the sinner's prayer on three different occasions. So I'm well versed with this form of teaching, and we're going to get back to what the Bible really says tonight. We're going to try to do some teaching. Now, what's happened in these verses is your pastor, your religious leader, has gone to these passages and has taken these passages and quoted. Here they are, these two verses: Acts 2:21, Romans 10:13. Both of them quote Joel chapter 2. We're going to talk about Joel 2 here a little bit later. Both of them quote Joel 2 and say, "Whoever calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved." And again in Romans 10:13, Whoever calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved. Now, these two verses, we love these verses, we support these verses, but what's happening in the religious world is people are taking these passages and they're ripping them out of their context and they're giving them their own definition. Rather than defining them according to the Word of God, they're giving it their own definition. Now, I want to support what I'm talking about. Here's a tract that some of our brethren picked up on a door. Let's get back up. We got the same problem again, James. Our slides are skipping around. Now everything that we talk about, we want to support and document. Now, when I say that they're taking can we back up? That's when it's jumping, is when I back up. They're taking these verses and they're pulling them out and they're defining them with their own definition. And we're gonna establish that tonight. This is a tract. What we're trying to look at here is a tract that we picked up, and it's from one of the local Baptist church that they hung on the doors around, and we knocked on a door and there it was, and we got it from the homeowner, and we want to be able to document what we say. Now what folks are doing is they're teaching the sinner's prayer, and this is it, Amazing Grace Baptist Church. If we can get back to it. Amazing Grace Baptist Church has promoted this, and it's not just them. Every Baptist church preaches this, not just the Baptists. There's a lot of folks that promote this. Just about anybody who is considered a Protestant church promotes this. Now look at this slide here. They're going to quote Romans 10:13. That may be hard for you to read up there at the top, but we already looked at it. Romans 10:13 says, "Whoever calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved." Now that's true. And what we're going to do is we're going to take that and we're going to define that for you tonight with the Bible. But I want you to notice from this tract, that's the last scripture reference that you're going to see. All the way down through here now, they're going to go down and they're going to say, God wants you to believe His Word and receive Jesus Christ as your personal Savior. Nowhere in the scriptures does it say receive Jesus Christ as your personal Savior. That's foreign to the Bible. Then you'll go down here, if you will, and he's going to say, now then, right now, in simple faith, pray this prayer asking the Lord to forgive you of your sins and save you. Now again, there's no reference for that. Everything we talk about tonight, we are going to go through and we're going to support with Scripture. And now here's the sinner's prayer. Dear Lord, now this may be something like what several of you have prayed. It's what I pray. It says, Dear Lord, I know that I am a sinner. I know that Jesus died on the cross for me. Please forgive me of my sin. Come into my heart and save me. In Jesus' name, amen. Now that's a typical sinner's prayer. Folks, of all the people we read about being saved in the New Testament, none of them said this prayer. None of them. And our point is that this is being promoted, and they're going back and they're using Bible to try to support what they're saying. But indeed, what they're doing, all that looks good. But what they're doing is they're taking this phrase, whoever calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved, and they're making their own definition. Folks, if the Bible doesn't talk about calling on the name of the Lord in this way, then that's not Bible doctrine. So let's look at that tonight, and we're going to ask for some callers here in just a moment, and we're going to get some input. We're going to see if this is really what's being taught. What we want tonight, the callers I want tonight, is I want someone to call in and explain to me that indeed this was what you were taught, and explain to me if I haven't presented it, if there's any more evidence out there that I'm leaving out, and talk to me about if I haven't done a fair job presenting the truth on this. So, how do we call on the name of the Lord? That's the question we're going to ask tonight. Now, here's the references. We already mentioned these are the two places that it uses this phrase, whoever calls on the name of the Lord. Now, both of those are quotes from Joel chapter 2 and verse 32, and you see it there, whoever calls upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. Now, here's what we need to remember, is that when we're looking at Scripture, we need to understand that Scripture was originally given by a source, someone either spoke it or they wrote it, and it was given to an original audience. Now, ultimately, we are the audience. But because we're 2,000 years removed from when these things were originally written, we need to realize that these were given in a context. And in both of these instances, Acts 2 and verse 21 is where we read, whoever calls upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. In Acts 2, if we back up a little bit, in Acts chapter 2 and verse 5, it says, and there were dwelling in Jerusalem Jews. Now, my point there is that Peter is about to preach a sermon, and he's preaching a sermon to Jews. And when he's preaching this sermon to Jews, he's going to go back and he's going to use Jewish literature. Joel was from the Old Testament. That was the Jews' scripture. And he's going to use Jewish literature, and he's going to present it to the Jews to support what they see happening. Now, my point is, if we're going to take a phrase that's in Jewish literature, and that was given to Jews, and it was used to tell the Jews about salvation, then we need to step back and understand, how is it that the Jews understood this phrase? You see, to pull this out and now define the phrase, whoever calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved, in a 21st century setting, and not give credit to the men who quoted this, that they used it from Jewish literature and they were saying it to Jewish people, to completely ignore the Jews' understanding would be unfair. So that's what we're wanting to do tonight, is we're wanting to go back. Now, also Romans 10 and verse 13 is where we get this phrase again. Now, if we'll back up in Romans 10, look at this. It says, "Brethren, my heart's desire and prayer to God for Israel is that they may be saved." Now, he's talking about Israel, that's the Jews, Israel being saved. In both instances, the writers are writing about the salvation of the Jews, and they're going back to Jewish literature to try to explain it. So, folks, we need to back up. And we need to not run off into the future and say, well, we're going to take this now, we're going to define it however we want. Instead, we're going to back up and we're going to see, how did these Bible people, how did the inspired writers, what did they mean by call on the name of the Lord? Now, the problem we have today is exactly, ironically, here in Romans 10, verses 2 through 3, Paul's talking about the problem the Jews had back in the first century. And it's the same problem, in its essence, it's the same problem that we have today. He says, "For I bear them," talking about the Jews, "I bear them witness that they have a zeal for God." Folks, the denominations, at least the one I was in, had a zeal for God. They wanted to be righteous people. They wanted to be saved. They really had a zeal for God, but the problem was, just like the Jews, but not according to knowledge. Their zeal was not backed up with knowledge from the Word of God. And it says, "For they being ignorant of God's righteousness." Now, ignorant doesn't mean you're stupid. It means you're uneducated. It means you haven't been informed. And that's what's happening, is folks are taking this phrase, call on the name of the Lord, ripping it out of its context, and uninformedly selling a poor product, a false product, to these people who have a zeal, and that therefore their zeal is not according to knowledge. It goes on and says, "And they're seeking to establish their own righteousness, and have not submitted to the righteousness of God." Now, folks, if we're going to take what God intended by the phrase, call on the name of the Lord, and we're going to make our own definition, well, you're going to see that very clearly here in just a moment, then we're trying to establish our own righteousness. Our plea with the churches of Christ are that we get away from those doctrines of men, and we get back and we let our knowledge be based upon the Word of God, and that we submit ourselves to the righteousness that God has in store for us. Now, when I talk about making our own righteousness, this is a man named Charles Finney. I'll need to step off out of the screen so you can read this. Charles Finney is considered to be the father of the sinner's prayer. Now, he was a man who lived and preached mainly in the middle 1800s. Now, look at this quote. This is what he admits about the sinner's prayer. He says, "The church has always felt it necessary to have something of this kind to answer this very purpose." He's talking about salvation. And he admits, in the days of the apostles, baptism answered this purpose. That's what the apostles taught. That's what the apostles did. They taught baptism to answer this purpose. He explains it. The gospel was preached to the people, and then all those who were willing to be on the side of Christ were called out to be baptized. Folks, we can find scripture to support that. Now look at the next statement he makes. It, baptism, held the place the anxious seat does now as a public manifestation of their determination to be Christians. Look at that again. Baptism in the days of the apostles held the place of the anxious seat. Now don't let that term anxious seat confuse you. Anxious seat was the original term that he used. It was also known sometimes as the mourner's bench. And Charles Finney and others would call people to the front of wherever it was he was preaching, and that was the anxious seat. And there he would ask people to either pray the sinner's prayer or to ask Jesus into your heart. Now, Dwight Moody, founder of the Moody Bible Institute in Chicago and Moody Publications,
he modified this and he started to call it the inquiry room. And instead of having people come down in front, he pulled them off to the side to a private room where he had trained counselors that would tell them, really pull on their heartstrings and give them some emotional story and really motivate them to say this sinner's prayer. Now that's that Moody form, that inquiry room, that's what I did 3 times. I was pulled off into the side room where I talked to a counselor, and that counselor then had us say the sinner's prayer. Now, Billy Sunday, Billy Graham, those are some guys who took this idea that Moody had and they blew it into the full-fledged sinner's prayer that we see today. And that's what most of you are hearing. If you've ever heard Billy Graham preach, that's what he asked people to do. He tells you, you can be saved right now, just say the sinner's prayer with me. Folks, that's the same thing that I practiced. And Finney is the one who started the whole giant ball rolling, and he admitted that baptism is what held this place in the New Testament. And today we have replaced it with the anxious seat. Let's see if we can back up here. Now, folks, if Finney is coming in and he's saying, this is what the apostles taught, but we're going to change it now, is he not trying to establish his own form of righteousness? Not using the form of righteousness that God provided for us to be saved, but he's trying to submit his own form. Folks, that's the danger of what we're talking about. The Apostle Paul said it happened then, and he said it was going to happen now. And indeed, we see that it is happening. So here's Finney. Finney's admitting, you don't have to take my word for it. You can go to the Father of the Sinner's Prayer right there. He gives you exactly what it is we're saying. We don't need to say any more. So let's move on and let's look at what call on the name of the Lord means scripturally. Let's ask for our knowledge to be, or our zeal rather, to be backed up with the knowledge of God and not to be backed up with the knowledge of Charles Finney or Billy Graham or Billy Sunday or Dwight Moody. We want to have the knowledge of God supporting our zeal and moving us to be servants for Him. Now, like I said, call on the name of the Lord comes from an Old Testament passage, and it's given to Jews about Jewish salvation. So let's try to understand what the Jews would think of when they heard call on the name of the Lord. What does call on the name of the Lord mean in the Old Testament? Well, we're going to look at a couple passages. In Genesis chapter 12 and verse 8, this is talking about Abraham. And it says, he, Abraham, moved from there to the mountain cast east of Bethel. And he pitched his tent with Bethel on the west and Ai on the east. And there he built an altar to the Lord and called on the name of the Lord. Now, if you're not sure what an altar is some sort, something that's fashioned for the purpose of offering sacrifices. It says that he built an altar. You don't build an altar unless you're going to offer a sacrifice. And he called on the name of the Lord. Now, my point is, and we're going to substantiate this, call on the name of the Lord in the Old Testament meant that you offered a sacrifice. Here we see in the very next chapter, Genesis chapter 13 and verse 4, it says, and the place of the altar which he had made there at first, that's what we just read, he comes back now and it says, and there Abraham called on the name of the Lord. Again, he goes to the altar and he offers a sacrifice, and that's referred to as calling on the name of the Lord. Now, if you doubt that, this passage is going to sum it up for us beautifully. This is the case of Elijah when he challenges the 450 prophets of Baal. In 1 Kings chapter 18, it says, therefore let them, that's the prophets of Baal, let them give us 2 bulls, and let them, the prophets of Baal, choose 1 bull for themselves and cut it into pieces, and lay it on the wood and put no fire under it, and I will prepare the other bull and lay it on wood and but put no fire under it. And then you call, now look, here's our phrase, then you, prophets of Baal, you call on the name of the Lord your gods with this sacrifice. Offer this sacrifice to your gods. And I will call on the name of the Lord. And the God who answers by fire, he is God. So all the people answered and said, it is a good thing. Now, it is well spoken. Folks, without a doubt, for the Jews, when they called on the name of the Lord, they were offering a sacrifice. They built an altar, and that's the way they called on God. Now, what I want to submit to you tonight is that calling on the name of the Lord, sacrifices in the Old Testament, were a form of communication with God. That's the way the Jews communicated with God. And God established this form of communication. We read about it in Leviticus chapters 1 through 7. In Leviticus chapters 1 through 7, we read about burnt offerings.
And if a person was to offer a burnt offering, well, they were to offer that sacrifice in a certain way. And the way they offered that sacrifice indicated that it was a burnt offering. But if they wanted to offer a grain offering, well, then they had to do it in a different way. And that communicated something different to God. And we also read in those chapters about peace offerings. And if they wanted to offer a peace offering, then they did it according to what God said. That's how they communicated that, God, this is a peace offering. So in offering these offerings, they're calling on God's name in these ways. For a sin offering, again, they had instructions about sin offerings. For a trespass offering, they communicated that way in a trespass offering. Now, if you were a Jew and you were going to call on the name of the Lord, let's say you wanted to make a peace offering. Well, you wouldn't give that peace offering. If you want to make a peace offering, you wouldn't do it a trespass offering. Because you're communicating a trespass offering to God. You're calling on God to forgive a trespass. You're not calling on God for the reason of a peace offering. So it was a form of communication that God established with the Jews, gave them instructions about it, and that's the way they were to call on God's name for these various different reasons. Now for a Jew, when he hears call on the name of the Lord, he's going to think back, well, Abraham built an altar when he called on the name of the Lord. And Elijah, whenever he defeated the prophets of Baal, well, he built an altar and offered a sacrifice when he called on the name of the Lord. And we have been instructed that there's all these different ways that we are to call on the name of the Lord and give these sacrifices. Now, the Jews had a problem. The Jews polluted God's form of communication. They took God's form of communication and they created all kinds of problems. You remember reading about when Jesus came into the temple and he cleansed the temple? Remember, it says that he turned the tables of the money changers over. That's because the Jewish priests, they found a way to make a little extra money on the side. They convinced the Jewish people that don't worry about selecting your own animal from your own flock. Just come to the temple and we'll have an animal provided there for you. And we'll sell that animal to you. And that way you don't have to worry about dragging some goat or some bull all the way up to the temple. And see, that way they could make a little extra money. Well, the sacrifices, most of it was coming back to the priests anyway, so they were double dipping on that deal. So that was a really good deal for the priests, but they polluted God's form of communication. Because now the people weren't selecting the best animal of their flock. They weren't actually making the sacrifice themselves. They were kind of cutting corners. The priests did a lot of other things that polluted God's form of communication. And that's why Zephaniah, when he's pronouncing woe on the city of Jerusalem, and he's speaking to the leaders of the city, and here we see a quote in Zephaniah 3:4, he's talking to the prophets, but the point I want to look at is when he directs his attention to the priests. Talking her is referring to the city of Jerusalem. He says, her priests have polluted the sanctuary. The place that folks would go to offer sacrifice and call on the name of the Lord, they had polluted the sanctuary. They have done violence to the law. Now, you're going to have to remember this verse. Folks, if we take God's form of communication and we change it, then He views that as polluting what He has made holy. He views that as doing violence to His law. That's God's opinion of taking and changing what He teaches, changing His language. Now, Zephaniah is very interesting because after he pronounces woe on this city and these people, he then comes down in the same chapter, verse 9, and he talks about the time of restoration. That's the time of the coming of Christ. And seeing that and prophesying that, he says, for then I will restore, now listen to this, I will restore to the peoples a pure language. Because the priests have perverted my language of sacrifices. And when people call on the name of the Lord in a sacrifice, they can't do it purely now because the priests have polluted the sanctuary and done violence to the law. So God says, I need to restore a pure language to the people that they all, that's talking about all the people, not just the Jews. That's talking about Jew and Gentile. That's everyone. That all the people may call on the name of the Lord to serve Him with one accord. The people were going to do it with a pure language that God was going to give them. And they were going to call on God's name, on the name of the Lord, and they were going to serve Him with one accord. Now here's the problem. If Zephaniah is speaking the truth, and we certainly know that he is, then there is a single language that all call on the name of the Lord with. Folks, if you said the sinner's prayer, what language did you say it in? You see, in the First Testament, if the sinner's prayer is anywhere in the New Testament, then those people likely said it in the Greek language. So even if there was a sinner's prayer, which there's not, it would have had to have been said with a pure language that God was going to give the people. English language won't work. If you want to be saved by the sinner's prayer, even if it were in the Bible, then you would have to learn the language that the people in the New Testament said it by. Folks, we're not talking about a verbal language anyway. We're going to prove that to you tonight. The other point I want to make is that all people were going to call on the name of the Lord, and they were going to serve Him with one accord. That means with one purpose, with one intent. So folks, we don't see that the religious world is serving God with one accord today. We see all sorts of different types of doctrines and teachings. They're not serving with one accord. They're serving with many different accords, many different agendas. And in the Church of Christ, we're trying to get people to come back to the knowledge of God and truly to serve God with one accord. See, it can't be that we serve God according to Josh's accord or Johnny's accord or James' accord. We have to serve God with one accord, and that accord has to be the one that's established by God. You know, James was mentioning to me on the way up here that he, first night that he did the television program, he did it with Brother Kevin Pendergrass. And he got on the television show, didn't know Kevin Pendergrass, just met him less than 48 hours previously. They hadn't had a chance to talk about anything. And they got on the television program. They didn't need to interview each other before that because they know they're following the same book. And they got on there and they could just nearly complete each other's sentences. They were speaking the same thing because they're serving God with one accord. Folks, that's what we're asking people to get back to. Let's do away with the religious confusion. Now, when we talk about calling on the name of the Lord, Zephaniah said it would be done by a pure language. Our question now is, what is that pure language by which all must call on the name of the Lord? What is that language? Let's go back now to the New Testament and look at some of these passages. We're having problems again, James. I don't know what the deal is. Okay, that's why I hit the left one. For some reason, we keep skipping our next slide. See if you can get me back there. We go back to the New Testament. If you've got your Bible, go ahead and flip over to Acts chapter 2. That's where we're going to be. That's fine. I'll go to my Bible program now. Okay? So let's go now to our New Testament. We're going to ask the question then, what... Okay, there we go. We're up, I think. That's fine. That'll work. Okay, we're going to... Well, I don't have it here. I don't have it here, James. Let me see if I can... Hold on, it may be coming up now. All right, we're going to get right to it. Bear with me just a moment. There we go. Okay, we're going to go to Acts chapter 2, and that's where we are. Okay, and I've got it right here. Perfect. Let's see if I can change that. Nope, I can't do it. Can't do it. See if you can bring it back over onto the screen. In Acts chapter 2, we're going to go back to where Peter told the people they need to call on the name of the Lord. Again, he's talking to Jews, and he's telling Jews how to be saved. And he's telling them and explaining it to them by going back to the Old Testament. And he gives this quote. Now, let me give you some background on what's happened. The apostles are there in Jerusalem, and there comes to them, see if you can change that... I may just get you to run that for me. The apostles have received the Holy Spirit has come upon them, and they're speaking in all sorts of tongues. And the Jews hear this, and they all come around as Jews from all sorts of different nations. And they hear the apostles speaking in their native tongue, and they're perplexed. And they ask, what could this be? Some said, these guys are drunk. And Peter comes down, and he says, no, they're not drunk. That's not the case, for it's the third hour. Let's see, we can stop. Let's see. Let's go to verse 21. He says, no, they're not drunk. He says, this is what the prophet Joel spoke of. And then he gives that prophecy from Joel that this time would come when they would speak in tongues, when his men servants and maid servants would all speak in tongues. And he concludes that prophecy. Are we Acts 2:21? Yeah, there we go. And he concludes that prophecy and says, and it shall be that whosoever call on the name of the Lord shall be saved. Now, folks, that's what he's saying in this to begin this sermon. to try to convince these Jews to be saved. Now let's go to verse 36. Peter preaches about Christ and that he was a man that was attested by miracles. And in verse 36, he basically comes and sums up what his whole sermon is about. And he says, therefore, let the house of Israel know assuredly, there we are, let the house of Israel know therefore, know assuredly that God hath made him both Lord and Christ, this Jesus whom ye crucified. He's made Jesus both Lord and Christ. Now the Jews heard this, and it says they were pricked in the heart. So that means they believed what it was that they were that Peter was saying. And they said unto Peter and the rest of the apostles, let's scroll down a little bit, brethren, what shall we do? Now understand that Peter has said, whoever calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved. He said what Joel prophesied about this coming time of salvation is what you see right now. And whoever calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved. Now these Jews, we've already established, they're immediately thinking back to sacrifice. And they're thinking, well, what do? Burn sacrifice? Grain sacrifice? We do sin sacrifice? A trespass sacrifice? Is it a peace offering? What kind of sacrifice do we give? So they're perplexed and they're convicted. And they're saying, men and brethren, what do? Their question is, how do we call on the name of the Lord? How do we do this? Now, if it were the sinner's prayer, wouldn't Peter have said, well, just come to the front and tell Jesus you know that you're a sinner and you need him to come into your life and forgive you of your sins. Folks, that's not what Peter said. Look at verse 38. His answer to them, and Peter said unto them, repent ye and be baptized every one of you in the name of Jesus Christ unto the remission of sins. You need to have your sins forgiven. That's what you need to be saved from. So repent and be baptized. Now scroll down to verse 40. I don't know what other words Peter used. It says, and with many other words, he testified and exhorted them. What I do know is he told them to be baptized in order to call on the name of the Lord. That was the pure language that all of these people who spoke all these different languages, he didn't say, now, some of you speak one language and some of you speak another, and you need to say the sinner's prayer in your own language. No, he said there's one language. And that one language is baptism. Now, I don't know what all he said when he said many other words. He testified and exhorted them, saying, save yourselves from this crooked generation. I don't know what all he's telling them to be saved. And likely he's explaining baptism. Because look at what the result is. Then they that received his word were baptized. And with a pure language, they communicated to God, God, save me from my sins. God, I want Christ to be my sacrifice. I want the forgiveness of sins. Now, let's look at another instance. And Scotty, I'll tell you what, let's go ahead and bring up the phone lines and see if we can get some folks calling in. At this point, I'd like to hear any input that somebody might have. So let's put the phone lines up and see if we can get a caller. Now, let's look at another instance. This is one instance of people calling on the name of the Lord. Let's look at another instance here. If you got your Bibles at home, go ahead. I want to encourage you to go with us. We're going to go to Acts 22 and verse 16. Now, this is the conversion of Saul, who eventually became the Apostle Paul. And I want you to look at what he's told about his sins. Now, let me note that Saul saw Jesus on the road to Damascus, and he recognized Jesus. He even confessed him as Lord. And it says for 3 days that he had been praying and fasting. Folks, if there was a sinner's prayer, Saul would have said it in those 3 days. He was a sincere man who really wanted salvation, and he understood that he was wrong, that he was in the religion of the Jews, and he needed to get out of that and get into the religion of Christ. If there were a sinner's prayer, I'll promise you that Saul said it during those 3 days. Folks, there's not. And because of that, Ananias comes to Saul, and he says this, and now why tarriest thou? Why are you waiting? Arise and be baptized. Look, and wash away your sins. See, Saul hadn't had this forgiveness of sins yet. Be baptized, wash away your sins. Now, here's our phrase. Calling on his name. Folks, that's calling on the name of the Lord. That's what we're talking about this evening. That's what we're trying to support when we want the righteousness of God. Let's take a call here. Hello, caller. You're on. What does the Bible say?
Here's the question I asked. So, I mean, the person that was on the cross, when Jesus was on the cross with the thieves, and he asked for forgiveness of his sin, so that means that guy, the thief that got saved, went to hell with Jesus. He didn't go to heaven. He went to hell. But he had a chance to get baptized. So that means the guy, the thief was saved on the cross. He didn't go to heaven. He went to hell because he didn't get a chance to be baptized on the cross, did he?
Okay, okay. Now, hold on. You asked me a question. Let me answer.
I always say, I feel for you, because the people that you mislead, their blood will be on your hand when you go to heaven, because the blood of the people that you
okay, miss- caller, let me answer your question.
You have a nice night.
You asked, okay, caller, he hung up. He doesn't want to discuss the question he had. What I need to do, just get out of that? Okay. He came in and he wanted to say his piece. And notice, he mentioned the thief on the cross. If you couldn't hear him, he talked about the thief on the cross. He said he didn't have a chance to be baptized. Well, let's begin right there. The thief on the cross went to heaven. And I'm not going to say he didn't. No one's going to say he didn't, because the Lord said, today you will be with me in paradise. But how do we know the thief on the cross didn't get a chance to be baptized? What we know is that John the Baptist went about everywhere, and it says all of Judea came to John of the Baptist and received his baptism. If the thief on the cross was in that area, and likely he was, then he had an ample chance to be saved. But here's the point. The thief on the cross didn't have to be baptized, because the Lord told him that he would be saved. Now, folks, if Jesus tells me that I'm going to be saved, then that's indeed what I'm going to, what's going to happen. I'm going to be saved. I think I can get back to it. There we go. If Jesus says somebody's going to be saved, then they're going to be saved. I've got to look up here at this screen. Okay. Let's go to Romans 6, because the caller, unfortunately, didn't have an understanding of what baptism is. How do I scroll down from there? I want to go to Romans 6. We'll start in verse 3. Folks, the caller doesn't understand what baptism is, and that's our problem, is he has a zeal to be righteous, but it's in ignorance. It's not according to knowledge. Caller, I hope you're watching, because this is what baptism is. When Paul talks about baptisms, he says, or are ye ignorant? What he's saying is, if you don't know that this is what baptism is, then you are ignorant. And caller, I'm sorry, I'm not saying you're stupid, but you're uninformed, and I hope that you'll pay attention to the Word of God tonight. Are you ignorant that that all ye who were baptized into Christ were baptized into His death? And we got a problem there for the thief on the cross. He's talking to Jesus. Jesus has not yet died. How in the world could the thief on the cross be baptized into His death? And it says, we were buried therefore with Him through baptism unto death, that like as Christ was raised from the dead, Christ hadn't even been raised from the dead when He told the thief on the cross that He'd be saved. So folks, this is what we're talking about. That's a common argument that the religious world puts out. Well, if baptism is necessary, why wasn't the thief on the cross baptized? Well, first of all, he probably was baptized by John. But second of all, he can't even be saved like you and I are today, because he couldn't be baptized into the death of Christ, and he couldn't be raised up with Christ. So that's form of salvation, although we're grateful that he went to heaven, that the thief on the cross went to heaven, it's invalid for you and I today. That'd be like going back and saying, well, I want to be saved like the Jews. I want to offer up a sacrifice, and I want God to forgive my sins because I kill a bull. Just as legitimate now for us today. I don't know why people say, I want to be saved like the thief on the cross. Why don't they say, I want to be saved like the Jews in Acts 2? Or I want to be saved like Saul on the road to Damascus? Why do folks go back to that? We're not even in the same baptism that we teach today. They couldn't be baptized into the death of Christ. So that's what we're dealing with today, and I hope the caller got the answer. We got another call here. Let's address it. Hello, caller. You're on. What does the Bible say? Caller, let me ask you to turn your television down. We'll be able to have a conversation.
Should I turn my TV off?
Yeah, you can turn it off or mute it, either one.
Should I turn my TV off? All right, I got it on mute.
All right.
I totally agree with the baptism, because I have been baptized in the truth, the Church of Jesus Christ.
Uh-huh.
But I have one question.
Okay.
I've sinned every single solitary day of my life.
Okay.
And I want to actually know how I can get back and make sure I will go to heaven? Can you answer that for me, please?
Absolutely. Great question. Do you attend church anywhere right now?
No, sir.
Okay. The first thing that you need to do is you need to get with a body of the Lord's church. Okay? In this area, that's referred to as the Church of Christ. You need to find the Church of Christ. What community do you live in? Can I ask?
I live in Eden. I got baptized on the Boulevard.
Okay. You need to go back there. James is hearing this right now. He may even know who you are.
No, it wasn't James.
Okay, it wasn't James. Well, go back to the Boulevard.
No, it may have been a James. I was thinking Johnny, excuse me.
Okay. Well, it may have been James O'Fill. I tell you what. Go back to...
Yes, that's him.
You need to go back to the Boulevard, and you need to talk with James. Now, here's the thing. When we're baptized, that doesn't mean we're never going to sin again. Okay? When we become Christians, that means that we recognize that there's a problem in our life, and that problem is sin, and we need to get out of that. Now, we can repent. What repent means is that we're going to turn and we're going to change the way we're living. Problem is, that doesn't get rid of the sin. We've got to be baptized, like Romans 6 teaches, to get rid of the sin. Now, that happened for you, but you say you still have a problem, you're continuing to sin. Now,
yes, sir.
There's two answers there. Okay? Let's look at a couple passages. Let's first go to 1 John. Okay. 1 John 1 and verse 7. Okay. All right. Now, this passage says, but if we... Do you see it on the screen there?
Yes, sir.
Okay. But if we walk in the light as He is in the light, we have fellowship with one another. Look at this phrase. And the blood of Jesus Christ cleanseth us from all sin. Now, that tells me while I'm in the light, as a Christian, while I'm walking in the light, I'm still going to sin. Because I still need Jesus' blood to forgive me of that sin. The key is, are you walking in the light? And what walking in the light means, that you're studying the Word of God, you're trying to find the sin in your life, you're trying to repent of it continually, get that sin out. Because becoming a Christian isn't just about going underwater. It's about completely changing your life and putting that old woman to death and becoming the new woman that God has created for you in Christ. Now, that requires study, that requires learning, that requires discipline. So in one sense, the answer to your question is, you don't have to completely quit sinning. We're not going to do that. We're not going to stop sinning the minute that we're baptized. What you need to do is recognize the sin, repent of it, and thank God that He continually cleanses you. Now, the other side of that, like I said, there's two answers to this, is in Hebrews chapter 10. Now, I don't know what your case is, but if this is you...
King James.
Okay, I don't. What I'm saying is I don't know what your situation is. This passage says, for if we sin willfully... Now, I don't know what type of sins you're committing. If you're not worshiping with the church, then that's willful. And you need to get back and you need to worship with the church. So if you're sinning willfully, after you have received the knowledge of the truth, there remaineth no more a sacrifice for sins. Now that blood that John said in 1 John 1:7 that continually cleanses us of sins while we're walking in the light, if we're willfully sinning, that sacrifice is no longer there. Now, I'm going to guess by what you've told me already that this is probably closer to your condition. Would that be accurate?
Yes, sir.
Okay.
So if I've willfully sinned, there is still repentance for me.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
I will not burn in hell.
If you return and live faithfully until your death, okay? Revelation 2.
I'm still going to sin in my mind, my thoughts.
You will.
Says our ways are not His ways.
That's right.
Our thoughts are not His ways.
So what you need to do is you need to change your ways. You need to go to God and say, now, God, you've been to God and asked Him about how to save you. Now, you need to learn, you need to go to Him for instruction about how to change your life. Let's look at another passage. Romans 12, verse 1. How do I scroll down here? Okay, I'm there. Can I use the arrows to scroll down? Okay, now look at here. Romans 12, verse 1. I beseech you, therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, He's talking to Christians, to present your bodies a living sacrifice. That's what you need to do. Now, the way you do that, that's acceptable to God, which is your spiritual service. Now, the way that you're going to do that is not just, it's not some miraculous thing that all of a sudden you know how to act like a righteous woman. The way you're going to do that is what the next verse says. And be not fashioned according to this world. The problem is your whole life you've lived according to the world, so you've got some habits that have been there a long time. But you need to not be fashioned according to this world, but be ye transformed by the renewing of your mind, that you may prove what is the good and acceptable and perfect will of God. See, that's what needs to happen, is you need to have your mind transformed. One of the ways you're going to have that happen is by being with other Christians. That's why it's essential that you draw close to the church. You've got to get back in the church. Now, tomorrow night, we're going to be at the tent, 7 o'clock. I would love to be able to meet you face to face. And I'd love for you to come.
What time?
7 o'clock, next to the mall there in Eden.
At the tent.
At the tent. Now here's what needs to happen. You need to repent. And it may be that you want to make that public, and that you want to tell people, I need some help. I'm struggling, and I need folks to pray for me. I need folks to encourage me. So what we ask people to do is to come forward and let that be known, so that everybody at the tent can know that we need to rally around you and help you to be faithful. You may have some public sin that people there know about. And if that's the case, then you need to make that correction. You need to let people know, look, I messed up. That was wrong, and I don't want to behave like that any longer. So if that, I don't know what your condition is, but if that's the case, those are the things you need to do. I'll promise you this. If you will come to the tent tomorrow night, we can sit down and we can talk about this, and we'll get James to sit down with us, and we'll discuss some of these things. And you have hope of going to heaven still.
Yes, sir.
Okay? Now, this is important. Don't blow this off tonight. Look, we've got about 22 hours before... Well, less than that, about 18 hours before the tent comes back around. Get there tomorrow night.
Yes, sir.
Can you give me...
I don't have to be rebaptized again.
No, ma'am. No, ma'am. When you were baptized, you were placed into Christ. You don't need to be baptized again. Okay? Can I get your name? Your first name?
Linda.
Okay, James. James said he knows who you are.
My last name is Golden.
Okay. Could we put you on hold here, James is going to get on the line and talk with you. Is that okay?
That's fine.
Okay, just hold on 1 second. Just hit hold down. Line 3. Now, folks, we love that type of a person. There's a person with a tender heart, a person who's gone to God and has established their righteousness according to knowledge of what God says. We love that type of person. Those are the type of people that we want. And she, unfortunately, she got back into her ways, and the Bible talks about how difficult that's going to be to get back and get entangled in those weights that are going to keep us from running our race. But we're glad thank you for that call. We're grateful that you have that type of heart, and our prayer is that you'll get back with the Lord's church, Lord's people. Okay, let's look at some other things. We looked at Acts chapter 2. We answered that. We showed where Peter's answer to what do we do, how do we call on the name of the Lord, is repent and be baptized. We saw that Ananias says to Saul in Acts 22 and verse 16, that Saul, ye need to arise and be baptized and wash away your sins, calling on the name of the Lord. Folks, there's our biblical definition of what call on the name of the Lord is. Now, you may be sitting there tonight, and I hope there's some people that are sitting here watching this, and you know that what you were taught was the sinner's prayer. Now, they may have said, and this is what happened all 3 times that I said the sinner's prayer, they said, now you're saved, your sins are forgiven, and if you want to, you can be baptized later on. And the Baptists teach that baptism is nothing more than just to say, hey, I'm already saved. Folks, that's foreign to the Bible. So if you're sitting there tonight and you're thinking, you know, I might have said the sinner's prayer, but I was baptized. And I know the Bible teaches that baptism is for the remission of sins, so therefore I must have been baptized for the remission of sins. Don't go down that road. The Baptist Church, for the last 300 years, has not taught baptism for the remission of sins. Now you might be saying, well, what's the problem with that, Josh? What's the problem with if I'm baptized, why is my baptism not sufficient? Well, let's go and let's look at another passage. I keep messing this up. You're going to have to bear with me. It's my first night to be on here alone. Okay. We need to go to Acts 19. Let's see. Okay, Acts chapter 19. Now, you may be saying, well, I was baptized. Well, here's my answer to you. Yeah, you were baptized. Lots of people have been baptized. All baptism means is to be immersed in water. If you've ever been swimming, you've been baptized. If you've ever taken a bath, you've been baptized. It's not that baptism, just simply going underwater, is not what saves you. It's not going underwater simply that saves you. Listen to me. It's going underwater with the proper faith. Folks, I have no problem with a statement that says we're saved by faith. We are saved by faith. But our faith has got to be a faith that's the proper faith. Now, here's some people who didn't have the proper faith. Acts chapter 19. And it came to pass while Apollos was at Corinth, Paul, having passed through the upper country, came to Ephesus and found certain disciples. And he said unto them, did you receive the Holy Spirit when ye believed? Now, look what he said. Did you receive the Holy Spirit when ye believed? And they said unto him, nay, we did not so much hear whether the Holy Spirit was given. Now look at Paul's conclusion. And he said, into what then were ye baptized? Into what then were ye baptized there? And they said unto him, into what then were ye baptized? And they said unto him, John's baptism. And Paul said, John baptized with the baptism of repentance, saying unto the people that they should believe on him, that's Jesus, that should come after him, that is, on Jesus. Now the problem is these people could, like the thief on the cross, they couldn't have been baptized into Jesus' death, burial, and resurrection. Because he hadn't died, been buried, and been resurrected when John was teaching his baptism. So these people had an improper faith. They were being baptized, they were repenting of their sins, but they didn't know because God hadn't said and taught. Their knowledge wasn't, their zeal was not according to the knowledge of God. It hadn't been given. They didn't know that when I'm baptized, I'm going into the death of Christ where I'll contact His blood. And His blood's going to take my sins away and I'll be resurrected with Christ to newness of life. Folks, that's Romans 6, 3 through 6. We were just there previously. That's not the faith that they had. We're trying to help people to have a faith that's based upon the Word of God. Romans 10 and verse 17. We've got another caller here. Hello, caller. You're on. What does the Bible say?
Yes, I have just had a question. If you could expound on it more, because I just heard you talking about the thief on the cross. It's in Luke 23, around 39 through 44 or so.
Okay.
Could you expound it more for me? And I gladly appreciate it.
Okay.
Because I didn't see anything about baptism or anything in there. If you could just explain that for me, I gladly appreciate it.
Okay.
Have a good night.
Okay, thank you. All right, we appreciate the question. We're going back to the thief on the cross, and here we are in this section. One thief says to Jesus here, and one of the malefactors that were hanged railed him, saying, "Art not thou the Christ? Save thyself and us." So he's mocking Jesus. And the other thief rebukes him and says, do you not even fear God, seeing that we are in the same condemnation? And we indeed justly, for we receive the due reward of our deeds. But this man hath done nothing amiss. He's done nothing wrong. And he said to Jesus, "Remember me when you come into thy kingdom." And Jesus' statement there said, "Verily I say unto thee, today shalt thou be with me in paradise." Folks, this man was saved. Now, here's my point. So first of all, to say he wasn't baptized, we can't say that. Because John preached a baptism. This man may have been baptized by John. And whether he was or wasn't, that doesn't really matter because Jesus had the power while he was on earth to forgive sins for anyone. And he forgave this man's sins and this man went to heaven. My point is, no one can be saved. No one can be saved the way that this man was saved today. Because in order to be saved like this man, we have to see and speak to Christ, and He has to tell us that we're saved. See, that doesn't happen today. Christ established a form of salvation, and he delivered it to his apostles. And he told his apostles that they were to go and to preach this form of salvation. Now, let's look where Jesus said that. We'll go to Matthew. Okay, let's see here. Matthew, see if I can get there. There we go. Matthew 28 and verse 18. Now, here's what Jesus said. This is after he's died. After he told the thief on the cross, you're going to be saved. After he's died, after he's been resurrected, and he says, all authority hath been given unto me in heaven and on earth. Go ye therefore, speaking to his apostles, go ye therefore and make disciples of all nations. How? Baptizing them into the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. See, Jesus hadn't even told people to go out and baptize with his baptism. My point also is, if you didn't catch the part earlier, is that the baptism that the apostles taught, here Jesus is commanding them to teach it, the baptism that the apostles taught, Paul explains in Romans 6. Now look at this with me, caller. Romans 6, Paul describes the baptism. He says, or are ye ignorant, or do you not know? He's saying, do you not know that this is what baptism is about? That all we who were baptized into Christ Jesus were baptized into his death. Now, ma'am, how could the thief on the cross be baptized into the death of Jesus when he had not yet even died? He goes on to say, we were buried, therefore, with him. How could the thief on the cross be buried with Christ when Christ had not yet even been buried? We were buried, therefore, with him through baptism. That's how we're buried with Christ, through baptism, unto death. That like as Christ was raised from the dead, well, that's tough for the thief on the cross. How could he be baptized like Christ was raised from the dead? He hadn't been risen yet. What Paul's saying is when we're baptized, we die and we're buried with Christ in the water. This is all spiritual. This is all by faith. This is our salvation by faith. In the water, God puts us into Christ, into his death, where we contact his blood. And then we're raised, like Christ was raised from the dead through the glory of the Father. So, that means so we also, like Christ was raised by the glory of the Father, we also are raised by the glory of the Father and walk in newness of life. Now, let me connect a lot of Bible verses for you. First of all, we need to have faith in God's working. We're going to talk about Ephesians 2, 8 through 10 later on in the week. And that says that we have faith in the working of God. Well, here's God doing his work. He worked when he raised Jesus from the dead. And when we're baptized into Christ's death, God works again and he raises us up with Christ. And he raises us to newness of life. You remember in John 3, when Jesus said to Nicodemus, unless a man be born again, here's your new birth. Born again. In newness of life. Now look at what the rest of this verse says, and we're going to take another caller. For if we have become united, you want to be united with God, with Christ? The way you do it is in baptism. For if we've become united with him in the likeness of his death, we did that in baptism, we shall be also in the likeness of his resurrection. Knowing this, he says, knowing this about baptism, this is our faith about baptism, knowing this, that our old man was crucified with him. The thief on the cross couldn't be crucified in a spiritual sense, couldn't be crucified with Christ because he had not yet died. But this says our old man was crucified with him through baptism that the body of sin might be done away with. Christ is the sacrifice for sin. But yet Christ had not died in the time of the thief on the cross. So he couldn't have had the forgiveness of sins in this way. But for us today, when we're baptized, we know that the old man was crucified with him, and we know that in baptism that the body of sin might be done away with, and we also know that we should no longer be in bondage to sin. That's baptism today. Now, I don't know if you saw it earlier, but Charles Finney said, this is what the apostles taught, and today we do something different. Today we offer the sinner's prayer. And he said, it has taken the place of what baptism served for the apostles. He was right on. I agree with what Charles Finney said. And I hope that you can see that if you've obeyed that form of doctrine, the sinner's prayer, that it's completely different from this form of doctrine. And to be saved like the thief on the cross is impossible for us today because the thief could not have been baptized like this. Caller, if that didn't answer your question, let me ask you to call back in and thank you for that discussion. Have another caller here. Hello, caller. You're on What Does the Bible Say?
Yes, I have one more question. It's about two other different verses.
Okay.
In Romans, it's Romans 10, 9 and 10.
Uh-huh.
And the other one is Ephesians 1, 7.
Okay.
If you could explain those verses for me.
Okay, hang on just one second. Did we answer your first question?
Yes, sir.
Okay, any confusion about that?
No, sir. If you could do that, I've really got to go, but I'm listening to you. I have a little daughter that I'm taking care of.
Okay. Pay attention here.
Thank you.
Okay. The question was about Romans 10, and we're actually, I don't know if we'll have time to get there tonight, but I was hoping to get to Romans 10. I believe her specific question was about Romans 10. Now, notice before we go to Romans 10 where we are now. We're in Romans 6. Paul's already told the church at Rome, don't you remember when you were baptized that this is the way you were baptized? So when we get to Romans 10, remember, he's talking to Christian people who were saved this way. So look at what he says in Romans 10. I believe we wanted to go to verse 9 was the question. We're going to get a lot of this here. Okay, verse 9. Because if thou shalt confess with thy mouth Jesus is Lord, and shalt believe in thy heart that God raised him from the dead, thou shalt be saved. Folks, I don't have a problem with that. The Bible says that we need to confess Jesus as Lord, that is, Master, and we need to believe that God has raised him from the dead. We do need to do that. And if we don't do that, we can't be saved. But some folks, again, want to go to this verse and say, well, it doesn't say anything about baptism. Okay, well, back up four chapters, and Paul gives the most thorough definition of baptism he could possibly give. So if we want to narrow a verse down to just right here, see, Paul's already dealt with baptism. He's already talked about it. In this letter, he doesn't need to go to baptism again because he covered it in chapter 6. But he's telling these people now, look, here's what needs to happen. You need to confess that Jesus is the master of your life, and you need to believe that he was raised from the dead. Now, within context, let's not just rip this out of its context, but let's notice what it's saying within context. Within context, as we established earlier, he's talking about the Jews. Now, why would it be necessary? Let's go back up here to verse 1 of chapter 10. Why would it be necessary for Paul to emphasize that you need to believe that Jesus was raised from the dead and that you would need to believe, or that you would need to confess him as the master of your life if he's talking to Jews? Look, chapter 10 and verse 1. Brethren, my heart's desire and my supplication to God is for them that they may be saved. Here's the they. For I bear them witness that they have a zeal for God, but not according to the knowledge. His desire is for the Jews to be saved. So he's coming down now and he's going to explain, here's what the Jews need to do. Their problem is they reject Christ. Their problem is they won't confess him as the Lord of their life because they reject him as a false prophet. Their problem is they don't believe that Jesus was raised from the dead because they reject Jesus as the Son of God. So what they need to do then is what Paul's emphasizing here. He's saying what the Jews need to do is that they need to confess Christ as the Lord of their life and they need to believe that he was indeed raised from the dead. That was where they're hung up. No reason with the Jews to go to baptism until they agree with these things. Now, if they can get online and in agreement with what the Word of God says here, now we're ready to go to baptism. Go back to what Paul taught in Acts chapter 2. Or not Paul, Peter. Peter in Acts chapter 2 dealt with this same issue first. He first taught them that this Jesus, whom you crucified, let's go over there and look at this. Now remember, Paul's saying that the Jews need to confess Jesus as Lord, and they need to believe that he was raised from the dead. In Acts 2, Peter's doing the same thing. Look at verse 36 in Acts chapter 2. In Acts chapter 2, he says, let all the house of Israel therefore know assuredly that God hath made him, Jesus, both Lord, that's Master, and Christ, that's Savior. He dealt with that first. Now, if the Jews had rejected that, there's no reason for Peter to go on to baptism. But look what they did. Verse 37, now when they heard this, they were cut to the heart. They were pricked in their heart and said unto Peter and the rest of the apostles, brethren, whoop, sorry about that, went a little too far. Said to the rest of the apostles, brethren, what shall we do? And then Peter answered them and said, repent and be baptized. That's the way you call on the name of the Lord. Now, do you see how that coincides with Romans 10? Both places he's dealing with the Jews. And in Acts 2, he deals first with the Jews. What you need to do is know that this Jesus who you crucified is Lord and Christ. And if you can believe that, and if you can confess that, then you're ready to repent and you're ready to be baptized. Now, here's if we go to Romans 10, 9 and say, well, it doesn't say anything about baptism, so baptism's got to be excluded. Well, then couldn't we also go to Acts 2, 38 and say, well, it doesn't say anything about believing or confessing. Look, all it says is repent and be baptized. Do we then reject Romans 10, 9 and say it doesn't say believe or confess? So we're going to reject that based on Acts 2, 38. No. We're going to see what is the writer doing in the context of both places. Here, Peter's already established. They agree. They believe Jesus was raised from the dead. They've already confessed that he's Lord and Christ. So now they're ready to be baptized. Now, Paul, in chapter 10, and we don't have time to get in this tonight, but we're going to go back to chapter 10, and later on when we come down here, he uses our phrase, call on the name of the Lord. And he says, whoever calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved. We're going to get to that and explain that within the context of chapter 10. Probably get to that tomorrow night. I hope that answered your question. If not, again, call back in and ask another question. We had another question there. Let's see. I think it was Ephesians 1 and verse 7. This is likely dealing with... In whom we have our redemption. Now, let's understand, that's talking about in Christ. In whom we have our redemption through His blood, the forgiveness of our trespasses, according to the riches of His grace. Now, folks, that's what we've been preaching all night. In Christ, we have redemption through His blood, which gives us forgiveness of our trespasses. And this is all according to God's grace. Now, let's go back to where we've already been, Romans 6. Now look at Romans 6. When we were baptized into Christ. Ephesians 1, 7 said, in Christ is where we have redemption. Only way we get in Christ is to be baptized into Him. We were baptized into Christ. And into Christ is where we came into contact with that blood that redeemed us and gave us forgiveness of our trespasses. The only place we can find it is when we're baptized into Christ. And if we were baptized into Christ, look there, we were baptized into His death. That's where the blood is, in a spiritual sense. Folks, this is all by faith. We can't find the blood of Christ in a literal sense today. I can't go out and find 2,000-year-old blood. So what I have to do is by faith, I have to trust this verse, that God is going to do this when I'm baptized. That's where faith comes in. But that faith is based on what this verse says. It's not based upon what the Baptist pastor says. Your sinner's prayer, you can't find that here. But I can found my faith on the Word of God. So we were buried, therefore. Now let's go on down and look at the end of this. We've already been here tonight. But I want to go ahead and cover it again. That passage talked about our forgiveness. Let's look here. Knowing this, verse 6, that our old man was crucified with Him, that the body of sin might be done away, that we should no longer... Now look there. That the body of sin might be done away with. That happened in baptism. So Ephesians 1, 7 is dealing with... He doesn't mention baptism, but he's talking to Christians who understood that in Christ, when you were baptized into Christ, that's where you receive this gracious forgiveness of sins through the blood of Jesus Christ. Thank you for your question. Hello, caller. You're on What Does the Bible Say? Hello, caller.
Yes, sir. I was wondering, I guess it's a quick, easy question. Exactly when did you receive the Holy Spirit in your life?
When did I receive the Holy Spirit? Well, I'll tell you what, we're not going to go there tonight. That's too far off of our subject tonight. Okay? We can answer that question later, but tonight we're not going to go there because I'm going to have to get into a whole different...
baptism.
Beg your pardon?
Was it before or after your baptism?
Well, how could anyone receive anything from God before baptism?
Acts 10, I see Cornelius and his family. To my interpretation and my reading of it, they received the Holy Spirit and then they were baptized.
Okay, I'm going to answer your question about Cornelius, and I'm going to rely on you to go back and study this, okay? So listen to my explanation. I don't have time to get into it tonight, but I want you to go back and look at what's said there. In the case of Cornelius, Peter was told that you need to accept the Gentiles. He received a vision, and in that vision, all sorts of unclean animals were included there. And he said, what I've declared is clean is clean. Then he says, Peter, there's some men that are calling for you to go into a Gentile's house. Just go with them. You need to go with these men. Now, Peter's there, and he's preaching the same gospel he's preached everywhere else. And Peter preaches to these men, and while Peter's still speaking, the Holy Spirit comes upon them, and they speak in tongues. Peter's conclusion is, who are we to forbid water that these could be baptized? See, Peter still had a little bit of a problem accepting that the Gentile was a part of the New Covenant teaching. But when he saw that the Holy Spirit came upon these men, that was the confirmation of the vision that he saw, that what God has called holy, or what God has cleansed, let no man call common. So God's showing, and he's confirming the vision, saying, look, I accept these people. These Gentiles can be accepted. Now here's the crux of the matter. That's chapter 10. In chapter 11, Peter then is called to the Jews. And this is going to support everything I'm saying. Peter was called to the Jews and they said, Peter, what did you have to do with going into the house of a Gentile? And Peter says, guys, this is what happened. I saw a vision. God showed me all these things with these unclean animals, and he told me that I should go with the people that were coming, calling me to go. And he said, while we were preaching to these guys, the Holy Spirit came upon them, and there's an important phrase there. He said, the Holy Spirit came upon them as he came upon us in the beginning. Now, lots of people received the miraculous outpouring of the Holy Spirit between Acts 2, when the apostles received it, and Cornelius in Acts 10. We have one instance recorded for us in Acts chapter 8 where the apostles are called down and Samaria receives miraculous gifts. Peter doesn't say now he received the Holy Spirit like they did in Samaria. He doesn't say that. He says they received the Holy Spirit like we did back in Acts chapter 2. The Jews that he's visiting with in Acts 11 conclude, oh, then God has extended grace even to the Gentiles. My point is, in Acts 2, the apostles received that outpouring of the Holy Spirit as a sign that what Joel had prophesied had come to pass. That's what Peter says. The things that you see here, these men aren't drunk. This is what Joel prophesied about. It was a sign to show that salvation had come to the Jews. Problem was, the Jews weren't going to accept salvation for the Gentiles until God showed the sign in Acts 10 and 11. That they were accepted and they could have salvation. Point is, nowhere in the Bible do we see that speaking in tongues forgives sins. What we do see is that baptism forgives sins over and over and over again. After those people spoke in tongues, Peter and the rest of the Jews said, hey, they're accepted. He said, you guys need to be baptized. Okay, that's the short and sweet version of it. Go back, read Acts 2. Read Acts 10, read Acts 11, and if what I said is not accurate, call in tomorrow night. We'll talk about it then. Any other questions, caller?
Oh, he's off. I appreciate your time, and I won't burn up any more of it. And thanks, sir.
Thank you for the call. All right, that seemed like a good, honest question, folks. We're grateful for questions like that. Now, we've got, James, we got about 12 minutes. Is that what it is? We've got about 12 minutes left, and what I would like is I would like to have someone call in and say, yes, Josh, what you're saying tonight is what I was taught in my denomination. And whether you agree with me or not, I'd like to hear someone say, you have done a fair job of presenting the faith-only side of salvation. I even showed you their track. We've got clips of people teaching the same thing. If we need to, we can provide clips of those things. So what I'd like to have is a caller come in and say, yes, this is what the Baptist Church teaches, or whatever church it might be, whatever faith-only church you might be a part of. This is what they teach. And folks, I would love for some of you who have been taught this to call your preacher tonight. You've got 11 minutes. Call him tonight and say, hey, this guy's on TV saying that your form of salvation that you taught me is not in the Bible. Have him call in. We would love to have someone call in and show us where this is in the Bible. Because folks, we know it's not there. Now, why is it that we're going through all of this tonight? Do we want everybody to be lost? No. Exactly the opposite. We want you to be saved. We know that there are people out there, just like there were in the days of the apostles, who were going around and trying to establish their own form of righteousness. And they're going about and they're teaching a different gospel. Paul said in Galatians chapter 1, verses 6 through 9, that there are those who are going about teaching a different gospel, which is not another gospel, but they pervert the gospel of Christ. He said, Now listen, Paul said, if we, the apostles, or even an angel, teach you any other gospel, let him be accursed. Folks, I hate to say it, but that's the condition of Charles Finney. If he didn't repent of his sins before he died, he was a man who presented a different gospel. He even admitted that the gospel he presented was a different gospel. I want to get back to this quote tonight because I think that it's so important. If I can... Okay. I gotta click over there on it. Okay, let's get back up here. I want you to look at this quote. Right there. Here we go. Charles Finney. If you're just tuning in, I want you to look at the quote here from Charles Finney. The church has always felt it necessary to have something of this kind to answer this very purpose. He's talking about we need something to show that for people to show that they want to be saved. We need to have a way for people to call on the name of the Lord. That's what he's saying. Church has always needed something some way for people to call on the name of the Lord. He says in the days of the apostles, baptism answered that purpose. Folks, that's what we've supplied for you tonight. We've proven that scripturally tonight that baptism served the purpose for calling on the name of the Lord. We looked at lots of passages that substantiated that. And he says the gospel was preached back then to the people, and then all those who were willing to be on the side of Christ were called to be baptized. Now, I know you can't see it for the phone numbers there. It says it held, I'll read that for you, it, talking about baptism, held the place that the anxious seat does now, as a public manifestation of their determination to be Christians. Baptism in the days of the apostles held the place that the anxious seat does now. The anxious seat was 1800 language for the sinner's prayer. We can document that the anxious seat is what Billy Graham eventually coined the term of the sinner's prayer. Folks, here we have it right from the mouth of the father of the sinner's prayer. He's telling you baptism is what the apostles taught. Now, here's what I want you to consider tonight. What's the big deal? What's the big deal if my church teaches something different than what the apostles taught? Well, let's look at what the apostle Paul said about that in Ephesians 2, right quick. Talking about the church, let's scroll back up here. All right, let's pick up here in verse 16. All right, talking about Christ, he said in verse 17, and he came and preached peace to you who were afar off, that's the Gentiles, and peace to them that were nigh, that's the Jews. For through him, that's through Christ, we both, Jew and Gentile, now listen to this, we both have our access and one spirit unto the Father. So look at that. So then, verse 19, ye are no more strangers and sojourners, but ye are fellow citizens of the saints and of the household of God, being built upon the foundation. Look here. You are, let's go back and look at that previous verse. So then, ye are no more strangers and sojourners, but your fellow citizens with the saints and of the household of God, if, only if, verse 20 is true. If you have been built upon the foundation of the apostles and prophets, Christ Jesus Himself being the chief cornerstone. Folks, have you been built on the foundation of the apostles and the prophets? If you followed Charles Finney, then he's already explained to you that, well, the apostles and prophets laid the foundation of baptism. And now we're laying a new foundation. We're laying the foundation of the sinner's prayer. Folks, if you've said the sinner's prayer tonight, let me tell you, you've been built upon the foundation of the apostles, but you haven't been built upon the foundation of the apostles and the prophets. You follow that foundation which Charles Finney laid. And no other foundation can any man lay than that which was laid by Jesus Christ and by His apostles. We got one more caller here in 5 minutes. Let's see what the caller has to say. Hello, caller, you're on. What does the Bible say?
Hello.
Yes, caller.
How are you?
Just fine. How are you this evening?
I'm okay, I guess, but I'm a little confused. I'll flip it to you and talk to you on here.
Okay.
And I've watched some of where I live down here, some of the Church of Christ people. And I could get a little confused. Could you sort of give me an enlightenment on this?
I'm sorry, what is your question?
Give me a little enlightenment. There's two testaments, right?
That's right.
Okay. From what I've seen of y'all, y'all preach from the New Testament.
That's accurate.
Well, who wrote the New Testament?
The
Old Testament. The Old Testament.
Who